About the love of Christ. Do you know why I love Jesus? I love Jesus because he first loved me. Those who were with me during the leadership training, we say that we did not choose him. He chose us. You know, and that is the most unique thing, that you're not in the Lord because you're forcing yourself there, or you're trying to tell Jesus that you want to be there, but it is because he sought for you first. He loved you first. Praise the name of the Lord. And that's what keeps me going, knowing that where I am and in my relationship with Jesus, it is not one that is forced. I'm not forcing myself. I'm not pleading with him to love me. He already loves me as I am. Praise the name of the Lord. You know, when we talk about relationships, some people love you because of what they can get from you. People love you because of the way you relate and what you can give. Other people love you because it's a season. Some people come in your life and they're just there for a season. Others are there because of a reason. But when we talk about the love of Jesus Christ, it's for a lifetime. Even after this life, the life that we can see today, we shall live with him eternally. Praise the name of the Lord. So it's not a love that is going to be cut short just because things change. And you know, life happens. Praise the name of the Lord. And today we are going to learn about a few women in the book of Ruth that life happened to them. Praise the name of the Lord. They went through challenges. But as the theme of this day is, you are not alone. We are going to see how they were not alone. Praise the name of the Lord. And so I want us to turn our Bibles in the book of Ruth, chapter 1. Ruth chapter 1. Do we have our Bibles? Amen. Digital. I still carry my Bible. Digital. It's not old fashioned to carry your Bible, even if we are in the digital era. But if you don't have this hard copy, you can open your Bible on your phone. I'll give you permission. But make sure you don't read those WhatsApp messages that pop up. Yeah? We are reading the Bible. Amen. Are we there? Ruth chapter 1. And allow me to read. I have a number, so allow me to spend that time well reading the word. Amen. So I'm going to start from verse 1. Now, it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. And the name of the man was Elimelech. And the name of the wife, Naomi. And the name of his two sons was Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. Verse 3, the Bible says, and Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. And they took the wives of the women of Moab, and the name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. And they dwelt there about 10 years. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them. And the woman was left of her two sons and her husband. Verse 6, the Bible says, then she arose with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab how the Lord had visited his people, giving them bread. Wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her. And they went on the way to return unto the land of Judah. Verse 8, the Bible says that Naomi said unto her two daughters-in-law, go return each to her mother's house, and the Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. And the Lord grant you that you may find rest, each of you in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted their voices and wept. Verse 10, the Bible says, and they said unto her, surely we will return with you unto your people. Now, the verse 11, we find that Naomi continues to plead with them that they go back. And Naomi said, turn again, my daughters, why will you go with me? Are there yet any more sons in my womb that they may be your husband? Turn again, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, if I should have a husband also tonight, and should also bear sons, would you tarry for them till they were grown? Would you stay for them from having husband? No, my daughters, for it grieveth me much for your sake, that the hand of the Lord is gone out against me. The second time we find, and they lifted their voice and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. So we find the second time, she speaks and convinces one of them, and Orpah leaves and goes back. And see, this is the reality. She is too old to have a husband, and even if she got a husband by a miracle, even if she got sons, we cannot wait for them until they are mature so that they may marry us. That is a lot of logic. It is the reality. And Orpah left. Verse 15, and she said, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, and this is the theme of our meeting, entreat me not to leave you or to return from following after you. For where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, thy God my God. And where you die, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if aught but death part me from thee. And when she saw that she was steadfastly minded to go with her, then she left speaking unto her. When she saw that she was steadfast, she was fixed. She had already made up her mind. She had decided. She did not plead with her again. So they walked together. Praise the name of the Lord. I want to give you a little history about Naomi. The Bible says that they were from the tribe of Ephraim, and they were living in Bethlehem, Judah. And they gave birth to children. And in Israel, a child was named according to how the mother saw the child or the people around when the birth took place. Praise the name of the Lord. From the beginning, you find that when a woman gives birth, they would name a child maybe according to the circumstances, maybe according to the season, or maybe according to a promise. Praise the name of the Lord. And so I want you to understand the life of Naomi. Here she is. She is married to Elimelech, and she gives birth to the first son and calls him Mahlon. Mahlon means sickly. Praise the name of the Lord. I don't know what made her call that son that. Maybe he was a sick child even from birth. Maybe he looked pale. You may never know why a mother would call her child sickly. Praise the name of the Lord. I want you to see the life of Naomi. And then she goes ahead and gives birth a second time. And this time she gives birth to a son called Kilion. And guess what Kilion means? Weakling. Praise the name of the Lord. How many are mothers here? We better find out the reason and why some people got the names they got. Praise the name of the Lord. So I want you to imagine this life. Now, Naomi has two sons. One of the sons is a sickling. The other one is a weakling. So they're not healthy. According to the names, they're not healthy. According to the name, they're delicate children. So you can imagine what kind of a life Naomi had. She had to really take care of these children. She had to protect them from the cold. She had to protect them from anything that would make them even sicker or weaker. Praise the name of the Lord. And after reading and understanding the meaning behind the name of these children, I stopped blaming Naomi and Elimelech for running away when there was a famine. Because a famine struck their land, and they decided, depending on how weak our children are, we cannot wait until they die because of hunger. We are going to leave Bethlehem. And the meaning of Bethlehem, Judah, it means the house of bread. So we find this family leaving the house of bread to go out And who is more? I'm giving you a brief history. Amen. More was a result of incest because of our mixed ages. I'm not going to dwell on that. Yeah? But more came about as a result of incest. Hallelujah. We are so mixed up, I can't get deeper into that. Yeah? But do we get it? Mm-hmm. Praise the name of the Lord. So they leave the house of bread and they go to a people that are already cast. A people that worship other gods. They had a god that was called Chemosh. And in this god, they used to sacrifice even their children for this god. So they have left Bethlehem, Judah, where there is true worship, and they have gone to Moab, where there is idol worship, where there is pagan worship, because there is food there. Praise the name of the Lord. Are we together so far? I want you to see the life of this woman. And so they get there, but just because they are in the wrong place, and because the decision to go there was not Naomi's. In those days, their wives could call their husbands my lord. They were full of humility. I hope we'll get it back. Praise the name of the Lord. They were full of humility. They could not argue. If the husband says it's time to leave, they just followed. Praise the name of the Lord. So it was not upon Naomi. She would not be judged because she left the house of bread. But judgment fell upon the man because he was the priest. He is the one who gave the command, let's leave. Praise the name of the Lord. And we find when judgment struck, Elimelech died. And the Bible says that at a span of 10 years, the sickly and the weakly had grown enough to become husbands. And they had Orpah and Ruth. Praise the name of the Lord. But still, death did not escape them. They also died. So let's go back to Naomi. Here is a woman who is saying, I don't know what is wrong with me. Yes, I got married to a good man in a good family. But the children I got were sickly. They were weak. I tried to protect these children. I am now not only a widow, but even my children are dead. Praise the name of the Lord. I believe that is a great measure of pain. Praise the name of the Lord. And she decides one day, she says, no, enough is enough. She heard that God had visited and remembered Bethlehem, and there was bread. The same place they left. The famine was just but for a season. So God had remembered Bethlehem and there was plenty. She heard with the news that time and she decided, it doesn't matter how many years I've been gone, I am going to go back to my rightful position. I am going back to my place. I am going back to Bethlehem, Judah. I am going back to the house of bread. It doesn't matter how far I strayed. It doesn't matter how I came to be in this situation. I cannot keep blaming my husband for dragging me away. I cannot keep on mourning and weeping here because there is still something I can do. I am alive. They are dead, but I am alive. And because I am alive, I can do something. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. And so she decides to get up and she decides now it's time to go back. And we find that when she decides to go back, the daughters are like, okay, let's go. Why were they willing to follow her? Because they had seen what kind of a life she was living. They knew that she is not like their mothers. Their mothers used to sacrifice to the god of Chemosh. Their mothers used to worship idols. But Naomi is one who worshipped Jehovah, the real God. Somehow, the way she practiced her faith had become attractive to these girls. And they were like, there is something in you. And because of that, we want to follow you. Praise the name of the Lord. I'm going to speak to the women of the golden age and the grounded. You're the grounded? to your church. I just want to come and have a cup of coffee and we just talk. Because there is something in you. Praise the name of the Lord. And so we find that I had mentioned how she gave reality and facts and upper left. But today we are here to speak about Ruth. This very strong statement she made. It is so strong that so many people, after they find the love of their lives on their wedding cards, that is the verse that is there. Praise the name of the Lord. This statement is so strong that in many occasions, if it's a wedding, that is the verse that is read. Praise the name of the Lord. But this is a statement that was made by a lady. She was not an Israelite. She was from the house of Moab. But because she had seen the faith that was in her mother-in-law, she desired to be connected with her. Praise the name of the Lord. If you read the book of Timothy chapter 1 and verse 15, the Bible says that Paul was telling Timothy about the faith that was in him. And he was telling Timothy that faith is the same faith that was with your mother, Eunice, and your grandmother, Lois. Praise the name of the Lord. So now that you know your neighbor, just ask them, what kind of a faith do you practice? Is it a faith that can make somebody feel like, I want to make a commitment. I want to walk with you. Huh? Come on, talk to your neighbor. I say you get to know them, their names. Just talk to them. Ask them about their faith. Huh? The way they live their life. Is it something that can make people do those strict and tough commitments?
I try to make them.
Hallelujah. So I want you to understand the commitment that Ruth makes. The first commitment, she commits to move from her land to a new land. Praise the name of the Lord. Because she's going to leave the parents, she's going to leave her family and go to a land that she has never heard about, that she has never been. Praise the name of the Lord. She makes a commitment to move from the place that was cursed to a place that is blessed. So the first commitment she made was a commitment to move to a new land. Praise the name of the Lord. Number two, she made a commitment to subject herself to new leadership. She was widowed. And because of that, she was single and free. She could have lived her life the way she wanted. She had the freedom. She had the freedom even to get married again if she found someone. Praise the name of the Lord. She was in that place where nobody has authority over her. She's her own boss. But she makes a commitment to subject herself to new leadership. And that is the leadership of Naomi. Praise the name of the Lord. You know that's tough. Praise the name of the Lord. Committing yourself to new leadership. Number three, she made a commitment to have a new lifestyle. The lifestyle of the Moabites and the lifestyle of the Israelites was totally different. But she made a commitment to have a new lifestyle. Praise the name of the Lord. She also made a commitment to have a new lineage. Is it lineage or lineage? Huh? It depends with where you come from, yeah? The way you pronounce some words. She made a commitment to have a new lineage. It's not now about her father's family or her father's house. She now belongs to this lineage of Naomi's family. Praise the name of the Lord. She made a commitment to subject herself to the new lordship, the Lord and the God of Israel. So in a way she was saying, by the time we have been together, I don't think I should be sacrificing to the God of Chemosh. I want the new God. I want the new Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. And the most important commitment she made is a commitment with no limits. Because she said, where you die, I will die. You know, that is tough. It's not up to when you become old. It's not like, let me try, and then if it doesn't work out, I can just go my way. No, it is a commitment with no limits. Where you die, I will die. Where you will be buried, that is very, 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 very deep, deep commitment. Praise the name of the Lord. So we find that Ruth is not so much connected with Naomi. She is connecting herself to Naomi's family. She is connecting herself to Naomi's faith. She is connecting herself to Naomi's future. Praise the name of the Lord. And by the look of things, Naomi's future doesn't look so good. She's already old. She's saying, she's confessing, I'm already old. I cannot even get a husband. And even if I get a husband, I cannot have kids and you get married. Her case seems hopeless. But here we find Ruth committing herself to Naomi's future. Praise the name of the Lord. Isn't that deep commitment? I want you to just pause for a moment. And I want you to think through your life. And just think whether there is a friend in your life who has ever committed in those levels. Amen. We are not sharing with the leaders, we are thinking, because this is now very personal. Praise the name of the Lord. Our theme today is you are not alone. And when I was thinking about this and connecting it with what we have read, I came to understand that being alone is not a good thing. And you know why it's not good? Even from the word go in creation, after God created man, he gave man a work to do, name everything. Man was busy, Adam was busy. He would look at an elephant and say, oh, the way you look with your big ears and the trunk, you are an elephant. You are alive. He's the one who named all things. That was his work. And the Bible says that God would come at the cool of the day and have fellowship with him. But one time God said, it is not good. It is not good. Tell your neighbor, it is not good. What did God say is not good? Amen. And to avoid being gender biased, can we say for a person, not a man? It is not good. For? Praise the name of God. It is not good. I don't know what God saw. I don't know whether Adam was so lonely that he displayed every negative result of being alone. But God called for a meeting and said, you know what? It is not good for him to be alone. Do you know why we are here today? Because it is not good for you to be alone. And that is what we learn from Naomi. She has of fellowship. And that is why the Bible says in the book of Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 9, unto us a son, as a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. His name shall be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Praise the name of the Lord. And when the Lord appeared to Joseph, when Joseph was just about to leave Mary, because she's pregnant, and he's like, okay, I don't know about this. I am sure this pregnancy is not mine. But because I don't want to shame her, I'm going to leave her in private. So he's there thinking in his mind how he's going to do it. And then in the night, the Lord appears to him and he tells him, you know what, do not do what you're planning to do, because whoever is being carried by Mary, his name is Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Praise the name of the Lord. Because it is not good. Amen. Can you tell your neighbor that it is not good for you to be alone? Praise the name of the Lord. Emmanuel, God with us. The Word became flesh and he dwelt among men. Jesus came and dwelt among men. You talk of hunger, he knows what it means to be hungry. You talk of betrayal, you know, he knows what it means to be betrayed. So when the Lord is saying, I am Emmanuel, God with us, it's not a God who lives in heaven where there is the roads are gold, huh? And there is only praises there. It's not just about him living in heaven. He came and dwelt among us, and he went through the hardships that we go through, so that when you call upon his name, or when you say, Lord, I feel angry, he understands what it means to be angry. Praise the name of the Lord. Come on, tell your neighbor, you are not alone. First Corinthians 10:13, it says that no temptation is uncommon to man. Everything that you go through, there's somebody who has ever gone through. Why am I saying this? Because there are things that lead us to separate or isolate ourselves. When we go through trying times, when we go through tough times, we tend to think that no one understands. We tend to think that we will not be accepted. If people knew what I'm dealing with, have you ever been in such a state where you're like, I'm going through something, but I can't tell anybody because I am ashamed of my situation? Praise the name of the Lord. And sometimes we tend to isolate ourselves. We tend to set ourselves apart and we're like, okay, let me just keep quiet. Let me just cover it up. Praise the name of the Lord. But the Bible says no temptation is uncommon. If you are dealing with grief, there we have found a woman who was dealing with grief. If you are dealing with rejection, you may not even need to look far. Maybe your sister has dealt with the rejection. Praise the name of the Lord. If you have struggles, marital problems, and you keep covering and you don't want to talk about it, you don't want to tell anybody, because you think other people are going to laugh at you. They will not understand. We have one who understands. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Today I have come to give you assurance that you are not alone. Amen. You are not alone. Amen. It doesn't matter how tough you may be feeling, or it doesn't matter how bad the situation may look, it is always important to know that you are not alone.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. One time in my life, I was going through a very tough time. Very tough. I'm not going to give the details of what I was going through. And I had faced rejection, pain. I didn't even have a place to stay. And it reached a point I said, you know what? I think I'm better off dead. And I remember thinking all the methods of committing suicide. I analyze, you know, analyze which would be less painful, which one will be quick, which one am I going to go through with it? And then I came to a conclusion, why don't I just get in a bus and just go anywhere? I remember all the money I had with me. I got in a bus, I didn't know where it was going. It got to the end, like the last place. And I'm the last person. And they're like, where are you going? I said, where are we? It was late at night, it was raining. And the bus driver and some people are like, where are you going? I started giving names of places I had in the map. Not that place I know, so that they figure out where I am. And they're like, why don't we go with you to our place? And then in the morning, we'll start a journey. Where you are saying you need another bus? And we spend the night, and they were a very good family. We spend the night, and then in the morning, I woke up. And instead of getting in a bus, there was this large forest area, and I started walking towards the forest. And I went and found a place where I can just sit down in the midst of nowhere and started praying and crying, now God, kill me. Kill me now. And I stayed in that place for 4 days with no food, no water, and I'm waiting to die. And then on the fourth day, the Lord himself spoke to me with a voice that I could hear. And he told me, no, it's not time. You still have so much to do. Arise, because death is not coming now. It is not now. I may not get into the details of everything that the Lord told me, but I'm talking about 17 years ago, I got up and somehow followed a footpath, walked and found myself in a shopping center somewhere. I sat under a tree. I am weak. I have not eaten. I have not drunk. And I fell asleep. And then somebody just woke me up. And guess what? It is somebody who knew me. Out of nowhere, I was like, I was still a pastor by then. Pastor Lucy, what are you doing here? I looked at him and was like, oh, I had come for prayers. You know, in our country, people could go to forest to pray for fasting for many days. So I was like, the only thing I can say, I would tell him I had come to die. Let me just say I had come for prayers. And now today, I look back at that time and I look at what God has done. And I'm like, thank you, Lord, for you sent somebody when I needed not to be alone. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. You are not alone.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. It doesn't matter what you're going through. You are not alone. And I don't know whether the Abigail Project does this, but may you have a session of sharing stories. Stories, somebody just comes and says, this is what I have gone through. And maybe you are there thinking you've heard it worse. You listen to somebody's stories and you're like, wow.
I have not seen anything yet.
Praise the name of the Lord. You are not alone. So guess what? When Naomi went back and the women came celebrating her, she said, don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara. Because my life has become bitter. Don't call me that name. I'm not Naomi anymore. I have gone through pain. The Lord has dealt wickedly with me. I have been through pain. I cannot answer to the name Naomi again. Call me Mara. Praise the name of the Lord. To get to that place where you feel like you just want to be called the emotions you're feeling. Mara, bitter. So every time we call you, we are reminding him your life is bitter. But remember, when she went back, she did not go alone. She had Ruth with her. So it doesn't matter whether she was saying, don't call me Naomi. It doesn't matter whether she was feeling her life is bitter, because she was not alone. Her life did not remain bitter. Praise the name of the Lord. The Bible says that eventually, because of Ruth connecting with Naomi, she found work to do. Praise the name of the Lord. She did not spend her days just lazily in the house. She was instructed on how to find work and how to work. So she could go and glean in other people's farms. And in the evening she would come with food. Praise the name of the Lord. Naomi did not have to wait to be given by other neighbors who are feeling sorry for her. Ruth was a resource. She was the one now feeding this woman. She would come in the evening and come with a harvest, and they would get something to eat. Praise the name of the Lord. And number two, we find that through Naomi, Ruth was married. She got connected. She was redeemed. And every time I read about this, I'm amazed at what God can do. Because in the same farm that she used to go and glean, it is the same farm that became her property. Praise the name of the Lord. I have come to tell you that those moments of feeling that you want to isolate yourself are not forever. Can you preach to your neighbor and tell them they are just but for a season? They are not forever. Amen. Amen. Did she believe you? Huh? Can you preach like a preacher? Tell her they are not forever. They're just but for a season. You know, I always love this God, because he is able to turn things around. The woman who was saying, call me Mara. At the end of the chapter, the Bible says that Ruth gave birth to a child. And his name was Obed. Obed means worship. Praise the name of the Lord. So it is not just about bitterness. Her life now was turned around, and she was able now to worship. She was able to worship from a position of victory. Praise the name of the Lord. I have come to tell you now, you are not alone. And I believe that the Lord God will send people your way to hold your hand, to walk with you, until you get to that position where you can just open your mouth and just worship the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. We find Ruth was a Moabite. But guess what? When you go down in the book of Matthew, in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the five women that are mentioned in the genealogy of Jesus, Ruth is there. She's one of the great-great-grandmothers of Jesus. come to tell you that when you hold somebody's hand, when you walk with them, when the Lord comes to remember them, He will not forsake you. He will not forget you. You will also become the partaker of that blessing. Praise the name of the Lord. As sisters, let us not get weary of walking together, of holding each other's hand. When you seem like somebody is falling, just let her know you are not alone. I am going to walk with you. Don't think that you're wasting your time. Don't think that it will not be recorded. Don't think that you will not get any pay. Because when the Lord remembers her,
sisters.
You know, sometimes we let the fellow sisters just be alone because we think it's a waste of time. Or sometimes we feel like we don't have much to offer. Mm-hmm. What can I offer? Let me tell you. Even if it means listening. In the line of work that I do, most of the things that they're 99% is listening. Somebody will call me and they just want to cry, and I'm just saying, it's okay. I don't even have to tell you anything, but just listening to you and just letting you let it all out,
yes,
it brings healing.
Yes.
Praise the name of the Lord. Do not think that you don't have anything to offer your sister. Sometimes you just need to mention her name where it matters. You know, there is a place you can mention the name where it matters and things happen. Praise the name of the Lord. You might be somebody who knows somebody who has a solution for your fellow sister. All you need is just mention. But we are living in a time where people don't want to be there for others. But let it not be so with this project. Let it not be so with this ministry. That we can be there for one another.
Amen.
You're not going to let a sister do what I went to do. Attempt suicide because they feel alone. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I believe if Naomi had to walk that journey alone, I don't think she would have gotten there. Somebody who is saying, call me Mara. You can imagine the heaviness in her heart. That heaviness would be transferred to her feet. She wouldn't even get to Bethlehem because it was a journey. But because there is somebody who decided, I am going with you. This journey, you are not going to go alone. I have fully committed. Your God shall be my God. I pray that a time will come where we are going to be able to celebrate each other's victory. Like when I see you succeed, I know your success is my success. When I see you prosper, I know that prosperity is also my prosperity. When I see you excel, I know that it is for my own good. If we can get to that level, we will not let anybody suffer alone. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I don't want to talk much, but I want you to have a moment and think about something. We have pens, yeah? We have pens. I like challenging people after I teach and I speak. I want you to write 5 things you can do to a fellow sister to make sure they are not alone. Just think of 5 things. 5 things you can do, and you're going to do this year to make sure that a sister is not alone. 5 things you're going to do this year. It's a commitment you're making, just like Ruth committed. She made a commitment to Naomi's family. She made a commitment to Naomi's faith. She made a commitment to Naomi's future. And this commitment was promised and it was purposeful. So I want you to purpose this year. I am going to do 1. I am going to do 2. I am going to do 3, 4, 5. 5 things you're going to do this year. Let us go beyond ourselves. Let us not just be the me generation anymore. It's not just about us. Something you can do to make sure, to ensure a sister somewhere is never going to feel alone this year. Maybe you know a sister who has lost her husband recently. Maybe you know a sister who is dealing with mental health issues. Maybe you know a sister somewhere whose children have turned to rebellion and she's having a hard time. Just think about something you can do this year to ensure that that sister is not alone. Maybe you know a sister who is trying to go to school and work at the same time, and she has small kids, and sometimes it gets so frustrating and stressed up. Just think about something you can do this year to make sure that we are not going to lose anyone this year. Because nobody should be alone in this walk of life. Just like the Lord has ensured that we have Jesus with us, every day He is with us. Just make sure that you make a commitment this year. I'm not going to let a sister be alone. I will be there. I will do this. I will do that. I will do that. Amen. Hallelujah. Are we done writing? I want us to stand, and I'm going to pray for you with the commitments that you have made. Because it's not by power, it is not by might, it is by the Spirit of the Lord. We make commitments, but it is the Lord who enables us. It is the Lord who gives us the grace to fulfill and to complete those commitments in the name of Jesus. Just lift up your hands before the Lord. I'm going to give you a minute to tell the Lord to help you as you have committed yourself and mention your commitment before the Lord. Tell the Lord to give you the grace to do it. Tell the Lord to give you the wisdom to do it. Tell the Lord to give you the knowledge on how to go about it. Tell the Lord to give you a strategy on how to go about it in the name of Jesus Christ. Father God, we thank you today. Thank you for speaking to us that we are not alone, oh God. You have sent to us Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Oh Lord, you dwell within us, dear Father, and we thank you for we are not alone. And today we declare, just like Ruth who did not leave Naomi, we declare that we are not going to leave our sisters, Lord, alone, but we are going to walk with them this year of 2019. We thank you for every commitment that has been written down, dear Father. We declare that these commitments will be written in their hearts, in every heart, oh God. And Lord, we declare that you are supplying the grace to do it, oh God. The grace to do it, oh God. The grace to do it, oh God. For we cannot do it by our own strength. We cannot do it by our own power. But Lord God, you are able to supply the grace that is needed to carry out every commitment we have made, oh God. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask for wisdom, oh God. Give us wisdom, my Father. Give us discernment, oh Lord. Let us discern when a sister is in need, dear Father. In the name of Jesus, we ask for divine revelation this year, Lord, that you're going to reveal to us, oh God. Just like you helped Ruth, oh God, to see beyond the explaining that Naomi was explaining. Oh, we declare this year we are not going to be like Orpah. When faced with the logic and facts, she left. But we're going to see beyond, oh God, beyond the smiles, beyond the outfits, oh God. We are going to see beyond, my Father. You're going to connect us to your Lord, that we may be able to discern the sisters that need us to stand with them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We ask for resources, my Father. Where we need resources to fulfill this commitment, Lord, we ask for resources in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for you will supply to all of our needs, oh God, according to your riches in glory. We give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody say, amen, amen. May God bless you.